wanna thank you. I just wanna thank you. I'm so grateful. Cause I just wanna thank you. I just wanna thank you. I just wanna thank you. I'm so grateful. This ain't till I found my song. It is till my heart woke up. I'm scared rhythm of love. Can't praise you enough. Yeah.
Today to say, God, we're so thankful. We're so thankful for 6 years of our spiritual family. We're thankful for a new day of life. We're thankful for to be walking in here, standing up, giving you praise. Can everybody say hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
Everybody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right. Let's raise that hallelujah. Come on, clap your hands together, everybody.
Come on, sing it, sing it.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I raise a hallelujah.
praise you, God. You are the one we love and adore.
With about you. It's talking about you. You are seated in heavenly places. You are undefeated because Jesus has conquered it all. So I don't care what you came in with this morning. Every fear has to go. Every giant has to fall in the name of Jesus, yes. Right? So we're going to stand today and we're going to believe what God says about us. We're going to believe that he's the Father who cares. We're going to believe that the cross was more than enough, yes, to cover whatever fear and anxiety and disease is trying to come against us this morning. So let's sing that chorus, yes, again.
Cherith, give me 1 second. Yeah. We're going to do exactly what you said, but I want to do something right here. Jack, Jeffrey, who other, PJ, Jay, just take 2 steps forward, Jay. I want you guys to go around him, okay? Go around him. Come on, come on. For our church family, if you're visiting today, you don't know, Jay's one of the members of our church. He's a great friend of Brent and mine. Today, his son has been in ICU on life support for a couple of weeks now. And it's a very tough touch and go. Touch and go. And he needs a miracle of life, all right? And these kind of songs just sound like nice words until you're in a crisis. Until you're in a crisis. Many of you know what it's like to go through a crisis. And you know what it takes to get through that crisis. Our brother Jay is in a crisis. His son is in a crisis. Now here's the good news. The good news is that God has pulled him and his family through many crises, yes, before. And so as we sing this again, as Cherith leads this again, I just want you guys to prophesy over Jay. And Jay, as Cherith was singing this, when you go back to the hospital, probably later today, I want you to lean down in your son's ear. I know he's got all the stuff all over him. I want you to lean down in your son's ear and say, Dylan, you will live and not die,
yes,
to see the glory of the,
yes,
Lord, to testify,
yes,
of the glory of the Lord. And I want you to speak to him. You have spiritual authority in his life, and I want you to lean down and say, Dylan, you will live and not die. You will testify of the goodness of God. And I know you're worn out today, but we're your family, and we're your elephants, okay? And we're circling around you because you need this strength. You need this faith. But miracles, miracles come out of our mouth. And so to everybody else who's facing a crisis today, we know that our nation is facing a crisis. And if you don't have a personal crisis, you go ahead and believe for the United States of America. There's so much hatred and vitriol all around. We've got to pray that God brings all of us to our knees, that we love and respect one another. But whatever miracle it is you're believing God for, when we sing this, you're not just singing a worship song. You are prophesying to your problem. You are prophesying to your situation. You are saying God is bigger, and miracles, miracles are going to come out of my mouth as I praise him, and the walls are going to come crashing down. Can I get a loud amen from the body of Christ? All right. Here we go. You are my champion. Here we go. Sing it.
Champion, and giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, and I am who you say I am, and you crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated.
There was a sign up in my parents' living room all the years growing up that said this. It was right above the grand piano. It said, "Joy is the most infallible sign of the presence of God." There's joy in the Father's house today. And joy and praise break the back of that heaviness that's going on outside those walls. This is a safe house. This is the Father's house. When you're in the Father's house, you're in a safe place. A place where you're loved, you're cherished, you're encouraged. And And this is our spiritual family. What a special day today as we celebrate 6 years of God's faithfulness to us. And all these declarations of praise. I'm telling you, I don't have to look back very far to just God's faithfulness to my life, to Brent and I. Number one, we're gathering, having church today. Imagine that. Let's just talk about that. I'm talking to friends all over the country that still aren't meeting. They're not able to gather like this. So just for that alone, we give God thanks and praise. Hey, turn to somebody, air hug, high five them, knuckle them, whatever you want to do. Just say, God bless you. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
Morning. Man, who is excited to be in the Father's house this morning? Well, first off, I do have to say, happy birthday! Woo! 6 years! Woo! Who is excited about 6 years? Now, the good news is, though, today is also Pastor Londa's birthday.
75!
That age keeps going up every service. I just want you to know.
No, there's
75
people.
Oh. Now, really quick, I'd really love to sing happy birthday to Pastor Londa. Now, because we're live streaming and copyright issues, we can't sing the original happy birthday song, believe it or not. So I'm going to teach you one very quickly. It's very simple. Everyone's going to clap their hands very quickly, and it's just going to go like this. Happy, happy birthday from all of us to you. Happy, happy birthday from hope all. Very easy, right? All right, here we go. 1, 2, 3. Happy, happy birthday from all of us to you. Happy and come true. Hey, there we go. Happy birthday! Yay! Now, really quick, just to let you guys know, next week we do have the next couple of Sundays, actually, we're going to be talking about our serve teams being a part of the body and, serving the church and building the kingdom together. So just you do not want to miss the next couple of weeks because it's going to be a really amazing time. Now, I've got my board members here. They actually wanted to talk to Pastor Londa just for a moment.
Presente. Wow. It's a birthday present. So if you take it out and can we put it up on the screen here? So it reads, Londa, right here, the Father's House, with our greatest appreciation for outstanding leadership of the Father's House, presented to Pastor Londa Lundstrom, we commemorate your exceptional leadership of the Father's House as we celebrate 6 years to be the glory of God. September 20th, 2020, to know God and make him known. You know what? And Liz said this is made out of piano ivory, so it's special, the color of it.
Yeah.
Well, here, let's make it to sound more special. Huh? Yeah, it was a key.
I feel like a triple blessing today. Triple blessing. It's September 20th of 2020. That's sort of like golden birthday.
Yeah.
You know? It's pretty cool.
Right on.
Thanks, you guys.
Yeah. Is it?
I hope to live up to the kind words.
Yeah, I made a pun to Liz that this was in tune with being in key. Because of the piano color.
Oh, I'm laughing on the inside.
It was funnier when you said it.
But you know what? They do this at the talent shows. Isn't she the best of the best of the best? You really are.
I always tell her she's underrated.
real quick, from the visions and the turmoil and the dirt roads and the blacktop roads and the deep roads and the high roads, this woman stays solid. Yes, she cries and she goes through things, but it's all on behalf of the ministry and her heart being conditioned and ready for God. And it goes back into some real hard places. I mean, we talked. She's a human, but she realized she had a flesh flash. She wasn't going to let that block what God had in store for her. And he always moves you forward, never moves you backwards. So we believe her visions of road ministry, evangelizing, 100 churches being planted, you've never let go of those. Even when the tornado was surrounding you, you came out. You went through the fire, and you're coming out gold. So we commend you for that. So love you.
Thank you.
Let's give it up for Pastor Londa one more time. Thanks, sir. Now, I've got some other great news. It's giving time! Woo! Oh, come on. You guys were all pumped just a second ago. I said it's giving time! That's what I'm looking for. Thank you. Well, I know you guys know what this time's all about. All about God's tithe and our offering. The tithe is 10% of what we give and of our first fruits. We give that to God. One, for obedience, but two, because we know God will bless us. And we give an offering to say, God, we trust you, and we want to keep your kingdom being built and pushed further and further until every person on the planet knows your name. That's our whole mission statement here at the Father's House, to know God and make him known. We want to make him famous. Amen. And so we just want to say thank you for all of you who have given in this crazy, crazy time. And we just want to pray over you and bless you this morning and say thank you. Here's all the different ways that you can give online and all of these different ways. You can mail a check if you don't. All the different ways. We got tons of different ways to give, okay? So we have Pastor Kurt. He is going to be praying over us this morning. We have a video from Nebraska. Here you go.
Hello, Father's House. This is Pastor Kurt, live to you from Lincoln, Nebraska. Let's give to God together right now. As we give our offering, we are believing the Lord for jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, estates and inheritances, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, finding money, our bills paid off, our debts demolished, and royalties received. And I will give more to the work of the gospel. It's offering time. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
TFH
amen,
kids, amen. You guys are released.
Amen. Speaking of 100 churches, today is the day that we celebrate the birth of the Father's House in Bismarck, North Dakota. Can you make some noise? Make some more noise than that, y'all. This is big. This is big. And guess what? Guess who is going to talk to you right now? We have our amazing pastors, Pastor Scott and Pastor Brenda are here with some of their friends from Bismarck right now. They're going to get them up on the big screen. Can you all hear us, Brenda and Scott?
Hello, everybody.
Good morning, Father's House.
There we are.
We love you and miss you so much. Congratulations on six years. And we're so excited to be starting today the Father's House Bismarck.
Yeah, we're just on day one. And you guys are on day 2,185. So we get to share this the same anniversary date on when we start the church.
Yes,
how exciting.
Yes.
And we want to just introduce you to some of the people that are joining us today from the Father's House.
Hi.
Wave, everyone.
Wave. Hi, you guys. Hi, you guys. Wow. Hello, hello, hello. Yay. Hi.
The Father's House Bismarck is at the Kilber house for a little while.
I love it.
But we'll be finding a facility soon. We're very excited and look forward to joining together and linking arms across the prairie. Congratulations, everyone. We love you so much.
Congratulations. Miss you, but I'll see you on Wednesday.
Yes, you will. Night. Scott will be here. He'll be here live Wednesday for what in the world is going on. Hey, guys, could you just, I want to just pray a prayer of blessing. Hey, Father's House Burnsville, extend your hands towards them, would you? And I want to pray over you guys and your friends that are gathering there. You know what? The Bible says never despise small beginnings. And you too have a yes in your heart. And you obeyed God to go to Bismarck to bring your life, your flavor, this evangelistic outreach church to Bismarck. So let's all pray. I just want to pray over you all gathered there. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I want to crawl through the screen and give them all a big hug right now. And Lord, I'll do that one day soon. But today, a new baby is born. We thank you for your plans and purposes. From the beginning of time, you knew this day would happen. Thank you for those that are coming alongside the vision of Scott and Brenda to bring the word of God, to bring the life and the gospel to Bismarck. There's so many that are hurting and that need Jesus. So thank you for each one gathered there today. And Father, we just send our love and our prayers and our blessing to them. Let them just have more fun than they've ever had in their life and ministry. And thank you, God, for number one. We only have 99 more to go. We thank you for the number one, multiplication and extension. And we're all going to go up there and see them one day soon. We pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hey, for you guys.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
Praise God.
Hi, honey.
That's exciting. It's a happy birthday.
Thank you.
What a wonderful day to celebrate with our family here.
I know it.
I wanted to just say, Diane Sluter, it's so good to see you, dear heart. We love you. We've missed you. She's a Floridian now.
That means she's going to be going back. And guess what? Behind her is Jack. He's going to eventually be going back to Mexico, too.
That's right.
He's going to rip you out of our hands.
See. And then Terry Huffer, wanted to say hello to him. He's here today. Hey, and then next week, don't come next week.
Why?
Don't come next week. In fact, for the you that are watching, don't turn in to this. Unless you want to be encouraged. Unless you want to hear about the end times. I'm going to be talking about the rapture again and what's coming to a city near you. Oh, yeah. This is a wonderful time that we're in right now. And so I'm going to be talking about that, but I wanted to encourage the people to, if you have friends or people that are kind of trying to figure what's going on in the headlines, bring them next week, because we're going to talk about that. Young people, we're going to be talking about the rapture or the catching up of the church next week. That's happening. There's between 27 and 37% of the Bible that's prophetic. And so we want to talk about that because you need to know, and we want to talk about it. And I'm going to be talking about a pre-tribulation rapture. That's what I believe. And I believe there's a lot of support for that. And yeah, that's it. And it's going to be, it's going to be great. Sometimes I don't know what to say, I just yell.
He has Tourette's occasionally, and he just sort of bursts out. That's going to be good, honey. Hey, something else pretty cool is happening, too. And I want you to be excited with me. It's only taken me... Hey, how many have had a dream that just took a long time, or maybe it's still taking a long time to make happen? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm talking about?
Yep. Yes.
Is that him or me? We got to take care of that.
It's that plate in my head.
Yeah. 5 years ago, you know, my dad always said, Londa, you're going to write songs someday. When I started playing piano years ago, I'd be like, nah, I'm never going to write songs, Dad. You're the songwriter. You're the award winner. You're the one. I'll just play piano for you. Well, sure enough, I've written a few songs. Well, many years ago, Dad said, oh, Londa, you're going to write a lot of books. No, Dad, you're the author. You're the great author. He's my hero. I'm never going to write a book. Well, about 5 years ago, the Lord put it in my heart to write a book. And I don't know if it'll be next Sunday or the Sunday after that, but my amazing friend Dave Koschel has been working a lot to get this book ready. The title of the book is Living with a Yes in Your Heart. And the subtitle is How One Word Can Change Your World. So, Dave, thank you for burning the midnight oil. He is like another dad to me. I love you and Judy so much. And so this book, we're kind of doing all the behind-the-scenes stuff, but it's coming together super quick. So either next week or the week after, we'll do some kind of, I don't know, something. We'll do something fun, and I will have given birth to my first book. Yay! I know. And there's a whole bunch of other books that are right behind that. You know, it's funny when you do something new, when you extend your faith and do something that you've never done before, God honors that, and then that territory expands, right? The prayer of Jabez, expand my territory. So we've got several other titles of books that we're going to write one together. I've got two or three more I'm going to work on.
Sheep Bite. I'm working on that one.
Sheep Bite?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I like it. So, I like it. We know a thing or two about a thing or two about that. Anyway, so thank you for being excited for that with me. Now, here's what I'd like to do. The song that we're going to do, I'd like to do that as the closing. No, wait. We can't do that.
Do it now. Just do it.
This is ringing. I don't know if it's his or mine, but something's ringing up here. Do you mind just thank you so much? Just turn that down a little bit. No, I don't want to do that.
You don't want to do it now?
Nope.
You want to preach?
You're the boss at home. Here, I'm the boss.
Okay. Oh, really?
I love you.
Would you like to get a spanking on your birthday?
Yes. We'll save that for later, too. Okay.
Oh, one last thing. I did have an announcement.
Yeah.
I'm announcing today that we are taking back from the Catholic Church. How many were Catholics?
Yeah.
We're taking back today the sign of the cross. They can't have it anymore. It's all of us. It's an awesome deal when you're praying. Cross yourself. Represent. When you're going to go on a horrible ride, cross yourself. When you're meeting your mother-in-law for the first time, cross yourself. I'm telling you, so I just wanted to make that announcement.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, there you go.
Good.
Just saying.
Good.
I can tell she's excited about it.
I'm going to do that song later, okay? I'd like my pulpit. So here, today is going to be a little different day. Today is going to be a little different day. Thank you very much. When I was praying about this celebration today, the celebration of God's faithfulness. Thank you, Al.
You're welcome.
When I was praying about this, I felt the Holy Spirit say, Londa, you're not going to preach. I want the body of Christ to preach. How many are old enough, my age or older, to remember what's called testimony time? Okay? Today we're going to have a testimony time. We did this in the first service, and man, I just was so moved. And so today, this message time, and remember now, stick in here, because at the end of today, we have a very special surprise. It has nothing to do with me, but it has to do with all of us, and it's really super cool. So hang in there. I like surprises. So right now, here's what I want you to testify about. Revelation says this: we overcome the world by two things, the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So the very best gift I could ever receive is you giving testimony to God for what he's doing in your life, what he's done through your time here at the Father's house. It doesn't have to just be about the Father's. It's your testimony. God is writing your story. And there online, I would encourage you, even while you're listening to me, would you just put a test? Because I'm going to go back and read every single one later today. Just put a testimony or even a prayer request. Just, we're going to celebrate the body because we are a spiritual family. And so right now, I would like many of you, probably, let's start with seven or eight of you, jump up and come up here, and we're going to have a testimony time. Just jump up to your feet, come right up here right now, and just make a line, and we're going to have a testimony, your testimony. You're going to tell the story of what God's doing, why you're excited to be a part of the Father's house. Just make a little line right here. First up, thank you, guys. Thanks for coming. Come on over, sweetheart. Everybody say hi, Betsy, right here in the middle. Go ahead, nice and close.
Good morning. Good morning. Well, I kind of did the same sort of thing for a country Christmas, and that was over the time span, probably 11,000 people. So this is nothing to me, but I always want to share my story. Back in 86, I'm a recovering alcoholic. I was in the midst of an abusive marriage. I was losing my home in a mortgage foreclosure. And down in the basement of my home, in the midst of bottles that I had smashed in the midst of my drunken rage, I sank to my knees, and I knew this is not the way my life was supposed to be. I sank to my knees, and I cried out. I said, oh, God, please help me. I'm so all alone. And this supernatural blanket, I don't know how else to describe it, this warm supernatural blanket just enveloped me. And all of a sudden I was sober, and I looked around and I thought, well, I better clean this mess up. And I felt the urge to go to church. Stepped inside this church because I was thinking I'd be able to hear my doctor give his testimony. But I don't think I've ever told anybody this. This was a berm church, which means it was built up against the earth, the soil. I walked in, and if you've ever been in a dome, like a football dome, where the ceiling opens up and you can see the sky. Okay, I looked up, and there was sky and clouds. And I said, oh, this is fabulous. Can you see this? Are you looking at this? And I look up again. There's the ceiling. Well, what was that? Well, needless to say, I gave my heart to Christ, got my girls baptized, finished my master's degree, got my divorce, lost 20 pounds, started dating again, yada, yada, yada. So anyway, and it's just been one blessing after another, after another. So when they talk about the before and the after, yes, it's real.
Come
it's
on.
Real.
Praise God. Give him praise. Amen. Come on over. Come here, right here. Tell us who you are and give testimony of the Lord.
Hello. I'll keep it short and sweet. Praise God. Huh? My name is Jonathan Smith, and I knew her dad when I got born again in 74. I got born again over the telephone. Fella praying for me, a witness from work. And then what does he do? He tells me, would I like to go to a revival at the Cottage Grove High School? There's a guy named Lowell Lundstrom preaching. I didn't know Lowell Lundstrom from Adam. So I thought, well, I don't want to hurt my friend's feeling. I'll go along, and he even picked me up. So that's a testimony I'll share at another time. I'm not a member here, but it's more alive here than a lot of places I've seen around, so praise God for that.
Yeah.
And my testimony is that because of God's grace and the understanding he's given me, I'd have got the coronavirus a long time ago if I hadn't used my faith. Right. So we stand on what the Word says. Right. Otherwise, why did anybody go to the trouble writing the Word? I mean, what is it? Just a bunch of words, or is it real life that's in that Word?
Right.
Psalm 91 is alive in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Come on, sister. Hello, sweetie. Right here, tell us your name and give testimony.
My name is Esther Ferris.
I'm a visitor of the church. I come once in a while because my baby liked the church. But I want to be...
You don't like the... But your baby
I like
it?
The church too, but every time I feel like... I like the church, but every time we enter here, it just makes me tears. She's just so excited running into Sunday school, and I feel like I can't get her out of here, so we just can't... Right. I brought my mom. It's just like an awesome service, especially the praise and worship. I just like the church. But I'm here to give a testimony, two testimonies. Just going to be short. First of all, in July, my husband tested positive for COVID, and I was like close to him, and I have a baby too, so there is no way I could have like quarantined myself. So when I look, I start having some symptoms, and I'm already pregnant, so they say I was positive too. But then I trust God, said I'm not going to go to the hospital, I'm not going to get on any ventilator, I'm going to put my trust in you, God, and I know you're going to see me through. So everybody was afraid, your high risk, and my pregnancy is like you high risk pregnancy, you have a high risk pregnancy and this and this and that. But I kept at home and God blessed me, and I was still in nursing school. But my prayer is that I was in nursing school. This semester was one of the toughest semester because it's the second to the last for me to graduate. I had this one teacher that was giving me problems, and every time I call, I was just crying, like, God, I don't want to repeat this class. I said, if anything you can do for me to pass this class, I do not want to repeat this class. And every time I saw my grades falling, I would call my advisor, and I would be screaming, the Spirit of God said, pray. And I kept saying, I pray, but she keep doing the same thing. So I kept praying, trusting God. At the last 2 weeks of my school, I took my exam, and got 98. I'm so excited I was able to pass that class, and I'm in my last semester of nursing school. I just give God the glory.
Hey, is there another little baby in there?
Yeah.
Yeah, when are you due?
I'm due in January.
In January?
Yes.
Oh, I can't wait to meet. Hey, this is Pastor Londa. Be good to your mom, okay? Praise God. Praise God. Come on over, Siobhan. This. I love this so much. Tell us who you are and give testimony. Nice and close on the mic.
Hello, everybody. My name is Siobhan Hoover.
Hi.
And I know some of you know I have two little boys, Emzer, who is 11, and I have a three-year-old, Elijah. And I am not originally from Minnesota. I moved here from Kansas City, and I didn't even want to come here. I'm not even going to lie. I had fell on hard times, and my aunt, she was like, come on, just come. And I was like, okay. So I prayed about it, and the Lord said, come, and I came. But to make a long story short, why I'm here at the Father's house was I was praying and I said, Lord, I need a new start. So my parents, my dad has dementia and MS, and my mom is a stroke survivor. And so I am both of their PCAs, and I'm my mom's homemaker. So I'm a single parent and I take care of my parents and my boys. And I was at my mom's house one day, and I've told this before, but I just think it's so awesome. I was at my mom's house, and I was sitting at the kitchen table, and my mom turned on the TV, and you guys were on the TV.
Wait. I have to ask a question. That was the local cable TV?
Mm-hmm. On the Burnsville channel. Mm-hmm.
Now, Siobhan, let me tell you why this is so important. You know, we know that we're on YouTube and we're on Facebook, but can I tell you something? Mm-hmm. You have no idea. I just got like electric shocks when you said that. I didn't even know that part of the story. Mm-hmm. I assumed it was on Facebook. Because our media team, James and Dave and Cheryl, the head of our media team, and John Poor, mm-hmm. our John, spends hours and hours every week editing these messages and uploading and getting them ready. And guess what? The fact that you're standing here and what you're going to give testimony for is a direct result of their commitment to the media ministry. Yeah!
Amen. And so in that, the Spirit, it was like came through the TV and hit my heart. And I was like, oh my gosh, where are they? I didn't even know about you guys because I originally was at Spirit of Truth Church in Burnsville. And I was like, oh my gosh, I didn't know about you guys. And so I had never seen you guys on TV, didn't even know about you guys. So I felt like, okay, Lord, this is a sign. And the Lord had released me from Spirit of Truth Church. And I said, okay, Lord, show me what to do. What do you want me to do? And at that time, I sit still, wait on the Lord and be of good courage. So I waited and I waited for my answer. And the Lord said, go. And at that time, you guys were having the outdoor service. So when I came at first, because I remember Christian, I spoke to you, Christian. And you were like, at first, Vine, you were all standoffish. But when I came, like, everybody was just so loving. And at that time, I was going through a really hard time. And I just came in the love and the care was just tremendous, overwhelmingly. That sometimes I was like, oh, Lord, I don't know how to take this. You know, it was just like, but thank you, Jesus. Thank you for this love. You know, I really appreciate it because it's hard being a single parent, you know, and then both of my parents, you know, are sick. So I needed that strength. I need love. And I've been it'll be 4 months since I've been coming. But, and you know, you have that feeling of like, okay, do I belong? But you know, you belong. I belong. We all belong in the Father's house. I just want to say that.
She gives great hugs, too. Here, come this way. Come this way. I think you're over here. Come here, Chloe. Everybody say hi, Chloe. I'm so glad to see some of our young warriors up here. Give testimony. There you go. I can hold. You're great. Can I hold this for you? Okay. Go ahead. So what do you want to say?
My name.
How old are you?
I'm 14.
You look like you're 25, but okay. Meaning you look really mature for your age. You're very beautiful. Yeah. Chloe, give testimony of the Lord. What's God doing?
About a year ago, I broke my collarbone. And my stress was just building up because I used to do gymnastics and I play guitar. And it was my right arm, so I couldn't really fit my arm around the guitar. And of course, I couldn't do gymnastics, so... of course, I found ways to, I put my arm over my guitar, like, with my sling on it. So I went like that, and then I just played guitar, and that was helping me a little bit. But then, I think it was a Wednesday night, I came, and then Abby prayed for my collarbone. It was, when she was praying, it was getting, like, really hot on my shoulders, and then... It just didn't hurt. Like, when I came to church, I couldn't even, like, lift it up to here. But then when I was,
God healed it. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Praise God. It happened. And Benny Hinn didn't have to come to the church for it to happen.
Come on.
Praise God for great men of God that have a healing ministry. God used another teenager to pray the prayer of faith, and it healed her shoulder. Hallelujah. Thank you, Chloe. Good job. Come on, Abby girl. This is Abby who prayed for her. Everybody say hi, Abby.
There you go. Nice and close on the mic. Okay, before I came up here, I had to go to Cherith and I had to ask, like, is this too heavy? Like, should I not talk about this? Because it's kind of heavy stuff. But on September 21st, 2019, I tried to take my own life. I found some pills in the cabinet, and I took them, and I laid in bed, and there was just this moment of silence where I couldn't hear anything. But then I heard this voice in my head, and it wasn't mine. It could only have been God, and he asked me, why was I doing this? And I said, because I don't know how to solve my problems. I feel like I'm stuck. I feel like I can't solve anything. I feel like these problems are unsolvable. And he basically said, then why should you die if Jesus already died on the cross to solve your problems? How can any problem be unsolvable if a dude got nailed to a piece of wood to solve your problems? If he already suffered to solve your problems? And I was like, dang, bro, you just, like, took away all my credit. Like, how can I do this now? So, like, I got up, I called my mom, and we went to the ER, and I got a blood test and everything. And the doctor, he looked at the bottle of pills, like, it was empty, but he looked at it, and he's like, you're lucky that these were expired, because if you had taken one more, if you had taken these a couple days earlier, you would have been gone. But I'm not.
Yeah. Now, hold on. Now, I want to just prophesy this to you. You know, us preachers' kids, we all want to have our own special support group someday, you know. But I want to tell you that, you know, every one of us that have known you, I've known you since you were this. How old are you?
14.
Well, I've known you your whole life, basically. Woo! But you know, you probably can spit more word than I can. This girl was a JBQ champ, wasn't she, Liz? Yeah. And she, but let me tell you, you are a messenger and a spokesman for your generation. And the very thing that the enemy tried to use to kill you, he's going to pay. He's going to pay. And you're going to take that back, and you're going to use your story to help set other people free. Amen. Come on, let's give God praise for Abby. Woo! It takes courage for a teenager to do that. That takes courage, but the next time it'll be easier. It's her a year tomorrow that that happened? That's right. She said September 21. Yeah. Happy birthday, sweetie. Good birthday. Wow.
Wow, how can you follow that? God can follow that, and this is his story. So my name is Kelly Futch. I'm the ministry project director here at the Father's House. And the thing I want to talk about is purpose. Christian and Cherith were talking about serve teams. It says the title at the bottom was Serve the Church, Build the Kingdom, right? That's what purpose is, serving the church and building the kingdom. And for me, this morning, I had a whole bunch of stuff in my hand, and I said to John Poor, I got Ruby's Pantry clicker in my hand. I've got the Rural School of Ministry binder in my hand. I've got my phone that's doing Zoom in my hand, and I'm doing exactly what I love to do, all of this all at the same time. And that is purpose, right? Some people were like, how do you do that? I said, man, it just energizes me. Years ago, I went through a leadership class, and the thing I learned the best in that class was, who taught the class? That'd be Pastor Brent and Londa Ramsey. They did a great job at it, and here's the takeaway for me. Okay, so number one, for years, I'd been trying to find where do I fit in church. I knew the things that I liked to do, but there wasn't, like, just that spot. You know, I'd like to serve and make things happen and lots of moving parts. I'm just happier there. So anyway, this class said, find what energizes you and do it. Find what depletes you and get rid of it. Okay. And I started looking at my life and going, okay, this jazzes me more than anything I know. And so I remember sitting with lunch with Lana and going, okay, this is what I love to do. Give me something to do. And she said, hallelujah, I want like 50 of you. So she found me spots, you know. And today, like I said, I want to talk about Ruby's Pantry. I have the ability to serve my pastor. I have the ability to serve my church. I have the ability to serve the Royal School of Ministry students. And it is everything to me. So yesterday at Ruby's Pantry, all the volunteers, we had 262 guests that we served, or shares that we served, right? Families that we served. And that's amazing. I mean, that's more than we have in the last 2 or 3 months. So the information is growing, the need is growing, and so we want to keep serving. So my encouragement for all of you guys, if you're not on a serve team, get on a serve team. Figure out what it is that energizes you. And come up to us, come up to anybody who's on a serve team and go, how can what I love to do and what energizes me fit here? And I guarantee you, we will find something for you to do. So I encourage you with Royal School of Ministry too. This is just another thing that God has done in me. I've read the Bible for years. Words on paper, quiet time, read it. But the Rural School of Ministry is teaching me how to study it even more, right? And Dr. D's back there. I'm going to give her a shout out. She's one of our instructors. Rev, he's back there. He's one of our instructors. Of course, Pastor Londa, she's one of our instructors, and many more. But the biggest thing that I've taken out of that in this first three semesters is, this is Dr. D's thing, get a Strong's Concordance. So you guys, everybody can get one. See, I'm listening. Rev, I'm listening. Because here's the thing with the Strong's Concordance. You can read all the words on the paper and the Bible. Rev says, sometimes there's a word that just sticks out. And you don't know why it sticks out, but a Strong's Concordance, you can open that up. You can find that chapter, find that word. And the Greek is there, the Hebrew is there, and your mind goes, because it's so much better than just reading words on the paper. Amen. So there's a plug for Royal School of Ministry. If you're not in it, get in it. Start in January, brand new semester. So God has done great things in me, and I thank you, Pastor Londa, for giving opportunity. You champion growth. You champion love. You champion elephants, and I thank you for that.
Praise God. Amen. Come on. Speaking of serve teams, this lady's in charge of our hospitality team. Anybody? Here, let me tell you how difficult is it to serve on the hospitality team?
It's a blast. You know, the day before, all you do is prepare and think in your mind. But once you get here, it's like it all clicks. There's times where I'm thinking, you know, there's not going to be enough food. And we're sending food home. It's loaves and fishes. And we got wonderful people, and we're always looking for more.
Thank you for being our great hospitality director. Here's the mic. Give testimony.
Okay, I could go on for hours, but I won't. I'm going to keep it very simple and to the point. One of our children went down a very dark path, and there is a lot of stories of why it had happened. And that one day she's going to have a fantastic testimony and do wonderful things with that. But what I'm getting to is one day we had a membership meeting over at the office area, and Londa had said after the membership and everything, she said, let's just take a minute to pray, quiet your mind, and just hear God. But my issue was every time I had a moment break, I was always praying. I was doing the praying and not the listening. So then I started, you know, that moment, I'm starting to take control. And I said, no, God, talk to me. I want to hear your voice. And God said, I mean, it was loud and it was clear. Don't worry, I've got this. And I just sat back and I said, God, did I really hear you, or do I just think I wanted to hear you? And so on the way home, I asked Dave, I said, honey, did God talk to you about this situation? And he says, no. Why? I said, I heard God spoke to me and said, don't worry, I've got this. So then I know it's okay to ask God for a confirmation. So I prayed. I said, God, give me a confirmation that I heard your words and it wasn't just me. So I went to work the next morning. It was like 9 o'clock. I turned on my computer and KTIS gives out this, it's kind of like a poster picture, and it has confirmation on there of some positive word and affirmation. I opened up my email, 9 o'clock in the morning. The email read, don't worry, God's got this. I just sat at my desk and I just started crying. I said, God, thank you, thank you. So then there was a lot of prayers from this church that also knew the situation and was praying and praying. And then there was times where I would get phone calls and the dark path just kept going and going and just kept rolling into more darkness. And there'd be times I'd call Dave and I'd said, we just have to go and take care of this. And then I would just calm my mind and said, no, God told me he's got this. Stop trying to take control. I'm just going to make it last that much longer. So then there was a point where it just kept going months and months. And I said, okay, God, you've told me you've got this. Do you have this? And it's going to be cured, because no longer this problem's going to exist, because she's going to be up in heaven with you. If that's how it's going to be cured, I'm okay. we can deal with that. We can't deal with what's going on. And then after I released it to that point where I no longer tried to fix it, that was my breaking point of stopping my concern about it. And every time the devil would creep back in with a worry, I would say, no, God's got this. God's got this. And he does. And he's going to do magnificent things with this. Oh.
So good. I love you.
I love you. All the prayers.
I love you. Dave and Sherry and Tom and Carol lead a go group. After we get done with serve teams, I just want to plant a seed in every single one of you. You can be a go group leader. We'll help you with curriculum. We'll get you a DVD series. If you like to ride bikes, start a group of bike riders. Yes. Meet once a week and go bike riding. If you like to snow ski, start a Buck Hill Go group. If you like to sew, Carol and Bridget, they have they're always making stuff and serving and making quilts and sending things to our missionaries. And Cheryl, I mean, whatever you love to do, if you love to study the word, then have a go group that focuses on that. PJ, you're Brent and I, you should have a cooking go group. This man is the chef, and Dave, my gosh, you guys could have fun just getting together and like, yes, I think that's a great idea. I think that's a great idea. But I just want to plant that in your mind, because all you need is a yes in your heart. And just keep doing what you do and just do it with other people. But see, that's how we come together. That's how we love one another. All right, come on, Jay. I was wondering if you were going to get up here. Come here, honey. So there's some swanky boots. The only person with cooler boots is my husband. So that's good. I like it.
Hi, church family. I will keep this short, but I wanted to... some of you have met Dylan, and we've had him at church 3-4 times and really tried to get him involved. He just wasn't ready. He wasn't going to commit to the Lord. He didn't believe in church or religion or any of that. And we, as hard as we tried, Kim and I, it wouldn't work. And he was struggling mightily with addiction, and his life was just spiraling out of control. And here's a kid that had two cars and a boat and perfect credit, and he put himself through college. He was about to be making six figures, and he lost everything, including us. We just had to let him go, and it was just heartbreaking. He was admitted to the United. He brought himself in. He couldn't even walk. They had to bring him in a wheelchair. And he on Labor Day, by Wednesday, they were scheduling for emergency surgery. His heart valve wasn't functioning at all, and he was in rough shape. And the day before surgery, a nurse came in who was new to that unit. Never saw her before. And she walks in, and I said, hi, how are you? And she said, well, I'm blessed. And I said, well, I really like that answer. And we proceeded to, talk a little bit. And she said, well, has Dylan ever been saved? And I said, well, no, we've tried, but he just... She walked over, and she was on one side of the bed. I was on the other, and she proceeded to talk to Dylan. And that night, Dylan was saved. He accepted Jesus as his Lord. And certainly one of the most touching, happiest days of my life. And Dylan had a surgery the following day morning. He was in very critical condition. It was a tough time. And he remained that way for several days. 2 days later, my dad died. All I know is that I don't know how I could have coped without everybody, my church family here, and all the calls and the messages and the texts and everybody just standing with Dylan and me and Kim. And I just love you all. So the good news is Dylan seems to have turned the corner, and he's doing much better. And we all know the power of prayer. And so, again, I love you all, and thank you very much.
Praise God. Love you. I look forward to Dylan standing right here in this spot giving testimony. One day, very, very soon. Come on, KJ.
Amen, amen, amen. So, fantastic to be here. God's word is true. His word never fails. This year was different from other years. I guess I always say, you hear the saying, no test, no testimony. And early in the year, mom got sick. She got, it was a thyroid storm. It attacked her heart, and then it melted her muscle mass. She lost like 40 pounds. And during prayer and the devotions, the daily devotions, the weekly devotions that the staff does really get, I've been closer to God than I've ever been. I'm close to God, but, you know, I guess you can always get closer, and there's always another level to go. Not that I'm some super saint, because I am not that, but the praying, I remember praying, and God was like, Mama's going to be okay. Get her here. Do this. Talk to the doctors this way. And Cameron, my oldest son, he's had 6 heart surgeries, well, 7 now, and God reminded me while Mom was at the Mayo of all the times I've talked to the doctors and all the crazy questions that I asked doctors. And I asked doctors questions and the nurses that I've gotten into arguments with and put out because they're not saying right. And then just because you got to talk right to me because you're not just going to do anything to me or my family. So that's just how I am. And so all those conversations that I've had and me and the doctors were discussing Mom and they was like, well, yeah, she was really sick, but this is what she's going to do and this is how she's going to do it. And my mom and my lovely wife are very, very opinionated, I'll say. they keep me in line. And so it was talking to them, and then my wife got a chance. Mom got better, and then Yolanda got sick. And she had been diagnosed with lupus, so they said, but going down there, the doctors were just treating her wrong, her current doctors, but I mean her previous doctors, and found out that that wasn't the diagnosis, and they thought it was something worse. And I remember talking with God and praying as I'm there with mom and her, and I'm like, and the Lord spoke. He said, you're going to hear some news. Don't freak out. I got it. I freaked out anyway. I did. I was like, what the world is going on? You know, I really did. I had to calm myself down and get back to the word and remind myself of Romans 8:28, and that God never fails. He never fails. And then as Yolanda was getting healed and better, then Cameron comes up with a bug, and he's 25, and he thinks he's superhuman. And I was like, dude, you're not super. You have a foreign chick in your body. If anyone knows Cameron, if you hug him, you can hear him clicking. It's because he has a mechanical valve. And you can hear it ticking. But he's 25, and he thinks he's superhuman. And I'm like, dude, you're sick. Something's not right. I'm all right. I'm just taking some Pepto-Bismol. Like, dude. And I, like, laid into him. I was like, you are not. And Pastor Londa knows I'm pretty rough on him. I am. And she was like, is he okay? I was like, you know what? I'm taking him. I told him, don't come home until you talk to the doctor. I don't want to see your face. Until then, he went to the doctor, and he found out he had an infection. And infection attacked the valve. But God is a healer, and God is faithful. And as he was going through that situation, I was praying. I was like, well, is this the one that takes him out? You know. I asked those questions. And then God reminded me of what he told me when he was born. It was like, he's not your child. I loaned him to you. And he has a purpose on his life. Not your purpose, so you get out of the way. There's nothing you can do. It's not even about you. This is about him and me, and we're going to have a discussion. And he's going to feel this one, and he's going to be all right. And so we had really deep, deep discussions about it. And me and the doctors, I was talking with the doctors. I was like, okay, so what's up, doc? You told me 20. It was only 8. They were like, well, it was God, and it was some stuff that we did. And then I was like, well, what's going on? How is he going to say he's going to be fine? We're going to do these situations. And God is faithful. But through it all, it's never about you. You hear that saying, Pastor Londa says all the time, it's not about you, never been about you, it's never going to be about you. Those are opportunities to witness to someone else, because imagine going in that situation if you didn't have a family, or if you didn't have a church home, or you didn't know God. What would you be? Where would you be? And you see people like that, and the hope is gone. But then God's like, hey, go talk to them. I was like, I don't want to talk to anybody. I'm going through this. And he's like, hey, it's not about you. Tell them this word, or give them this prayer, or give them this. So it's God is amazing. God is amazing. His word never fails. And he always proves himself over and over and over again and over and over again. And just a quick plug for tithes and paying your tithes off, because the scripture says if you pay your tithes, he will rebuke the devourer from off of you. Amen. And that is the truth. And that's with health. That's with your finances. That's with your food. That's with everything. That's with everything. Even if you don't like the church, pay tithes. Because it's not about you. Never been about you. It's not going to be about you. It's about that relationship with you and God. Because God is going to take care of you. He is going to take care. His word does not lie. Yes.
And all three of them have turned the corner.
Yes. Oh, yes. Yes.
All three.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah. All three of them have turned the corner. And we got the right diagnosis for Yolanda. And praise God. Who else is testifying? Come on. Hurry up. Hurry up. Hurry up. Anybody else? Come get in line. Come get in line. Say your name.
Hi, I'm Denise. And I just want to say that I'm so thankful for this church, because it has taught me a lot of things as far as the unity that you have for each other, and it's taught me some boldness. My dad was really sick, and he was, like, to me, the greatest person in my life. Around Memorial Day, he was in the hospital twice, between Memorial Day and right before Father's Day. And when I took him home for the second time, he said, that's it. He didn't want to go back. And I said, okay, Dad, whatever you want, you don't have to. And I'd ask the doctors, well, how long do you think he has to live? What's his prognosis? Nobody would give me a straight answer. And his doctor would just look at him on the little thing on the phone and say, oh, he looks great. I'm thinking, are you nuts? No, it takes two people to move him around. He doesn't look great. And so I asked my dad, I said, Dad, where is your tank of life as far as how much energy you have? Are you at full, half, quarter, or near empty? And he told me, like, here. And so I thought, oh, dang, man, I got to hurry up and do all the things on his bucket list. And that was to have a nice Father's Day, go on a boat trip with my daughter and my sister and the rest of my family, and then to have a great big celebration for Father's Day, which I completed all those things. And then when my dad passed away, he wanted to walk out of the house with my mom, which my cousin came and told me. She walked down the driveway, and she said, hey, just to let you know, your dad died. And I'm just like, oh, great. And she says, I made all the phone calls, but this is what we're going to do. We are going to carry him out of the house. I'm thinking, I don't know who you're talking to, because I'm a nurse, but I don't touch dead people. No, it's not happening. Well, we got him dressed and cleaned up, my aunt and my cousin and I, and we were singing, we're crying, and we got him, you know, all dressed up. The funeral people, they came and put him in the body bag, because no, I'm not doing that. I'm not putting him in the great big Ziploc bag. Not happening. But my brother walked him out of the house, or my brother and my mom locked out of the house together. My youngest daughter videotaped it, and we all walked my dad outside and so that they could walk out together. But then my ex-husband, then when we buried the ashes and Londa had done the service, later on that night, my ex-husband ended up in the hospital with a abdominal aortic aneurysm that had ruptured, and he, within 40 minutes of him getting to the hospital, he had two surgeons doing his surgery, and he had a 50% chance of survival, which he survived. And then my uncle had died then after that, and now when my niece had gotten bit by a cat, and she's 31 years old, went in for the cat bite and a fever, and now she is, they found out that she has leukemia. So, but God is good, and he's going to see us through it. And anytime my mom gets weak, I just tell her to rebuke the devil in Jesus' name. And she's sort of wimpy, though.
Yeah, praise God. He's holding you.
Yes.
Growing strong in the Lord. Come on, come on. This handsome man's name is Jay. Everybody say hi, Jay.
All right, so hi, my name is Jay, and I don't know, really know if this is a testimony.
I had to talk to Cherith about it. Well, she told me what to say. But basically, I want to talk about, like, growing up, never, like as a family, we never really had a lot. And, like, we were always running low on money for things. And I talked to Cherith about it, and we prayed, and I would say, like, a couple days later, my mom got a new job, which paid a lot more money. So, yeah. That's all I have to say.
Hey, oh, I'm going to trip over here. Okay, can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Do those shoes happen to be the all-white shoes that I put on your feet at the shoe giveaway?
What?
Now, there's kind of a mural happening on the shoes. It's very creative, Jay. Yeah. Hey, guess what? I got another thought for you. Praise God, because I know God gave your mama a super great job and an increase. But guess what? Guess where more increase is going to happen?
Where?
When you get a job. I love you, Jay. Come this way. Come over here. Yes,
sir. I just want to jump up here really quick. First of all, I didn't tell him exactly what to say. But I just want to say, you know, my husband and I, Christian, are the youth and young adults pastors here at the Father's House. We've been here for about a year and a half now. And man, it has been a roller coaster journey, incredible. The hardest thing I've ever done, but the best thing I've ever done in my life. And it's our job to push these kids. And I can confidently say a year and a half ago, these kids wouldn't stand up here. They wouldn't even think about getting up here. And just the fact that they're able to share the testimonies of what God has been doing in their lives and just all the things that we've seen, I just want to tell you guys, we're so proud of you. I know you hear me say this 500 times every week, but we love you so much. We're so proud of you, and it was the best decision for us to move up here.
Yay! I agree. One more testimony, and then we're going to have a big surprise. Come on, beautiful lady. Tell everybody who you are and give testimony.
I will. Happy birthday, Londa.
Thank you, Lord.
God bless you. You're the beautiful one, the most beautiful. Thank you, Lord, for what you've done at the Father's House. I just want to praise God that my son, actually, when he was talking to his friend Joel, we said, you should come to church with us. And I didn't know, you know, what the kids might say and what Joel might say, but Kaleo was like, yeah, let's go to the Father's House. And I'm like, amen, amen, because we're friends of many churches. But I feel like God's spirit is so alive here, and God is working through the young people here, young and old. It's time for revival. And I just want to praise God for Londa's faith. And Brent, to stand on the word, to stand for healing, to stand even in the midst of great trials, and to be a light and a beacon to this city, to this state, I mean, to the nation, really. We're standing for great things here. And I just feel God's healing presence is here, his power is here. And they gave us a place to come and dance when we had nowhere to go and dance. And it's just an open door. It's a kingdom mindset here. It's a kingdom church here, which means it's not just about me and mine and what I want to do. It's about what God wants to do, and we're all one family. And so I just praise God that, you know what? We can stand on the word. It's true. And when we declare it, no corona is going to come near my dwelling. I've been to cities and the darkest places during this year, and no sickness has come upon me and my family. And I know that you guys are helping us to stand firm. Your testimony, your witness is helping us. So I just release a blessing here today, the favor of God today, and an increased measure of his healing power and fire today in Jesus' name. Happy birthday.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Jolene. Thank you, Jolene. We receive that. One more. Okay, one more. My Pastor Jeffrey. Yes.
Thank you. Hallelujah. Father's House. Happy birthday.
Yeah, the very first day in Father's house when we came. In fact, the message was about Abraham, and it just came to me. And we were talking about it on the prayer line. And Abraham, obedience. I thank God for your obedience. I thank God for your obedience, man of God. Thank God for your obedience to go. Abraham did not, and here we are after 6 years. And Abraham, the first place, I'll skip everything and go between I means a place of heap, that is a heap of everything that is a heap that is completely it's like something, a house that is fallen, a big heap of rubble. Heap. A-I, heap. Did I pronounce it well? Or whatever it is. And I have an accent. She understands me. That's why I love her. So between I and it was going to the house of bread. House of bread. And that place, he built a what? An altar of promise. And you taught that and it caught me. I thank God because of the altar that we have in this house. And it's the altar is built to the Lord. And I want to tell you, because of this house, so many altars have been demolished that did not belong to the Lord. So many altars have been, and like Abraham, you have stood, and as you're going there with that revelation, the Father's house. And I tell people all the time, we need the revelation of the Father. That's what we had in there. And on the prayer, when we were talking about you. We're talking about how you look at a mess and you make a message out of it. How a test comes and you make a testimony out of it. How it's a big rubble and you look up there and you see Bethel, the house, the Father's house. And that's why we have this house, because we know there is a house of bread, and we are not walking away from the house of bread. This is where we eat the word. Thank you for the word. We talked about it. We say, she doesn't say that, just she, as much as she says that don't be the hearer but doer of the word, she really does the word. Because we've seen you, like how do you call it, the thing that pushes the trash away, the big the bulldozer, that everything might fall on you, and you're like, and you push things out, and you keep on moving. You got an iron inside of you.
hey, listen, I love you, Jeffrey. Hey. Do yourself a favor and come some African church. The African Fellowship is here every 5:30. Do yourself a favor and come and sit like I do on the front row. This man preaches fire. He's a great preacher, and God is going to use you and your team to reach the African people in this city. Amen. Give him a praise. Give him praise. All right. My testimony? Okay. Okay, now look, here's what we're going to do really quick, because our time is up. I've enjoyed this. Have you? Yeah. This is exactly what I wanted. I wanted to hear what God is doing in you. And I know he's doing so much. And if we had time, you'd all testify. Now, a couple things. I know that my friend Terry is probably watching right now. Barry, you're here. Thank you for your ministry and taking photos. But Terry's been very, very sick. And she's got 3 or 4 things going on with her. But she's home from the hospital just to get well enough so she can go back in the hospital to have her gallbladder removed and other things. But Terry, I think you're watching. I want you to know I hug you. I love you. We're standing with you. We're praying for you. Can't wait for you to be your little bouncy self sitting on the front row again very, very soon. So know that you are loved. Okay, I think it's time for a surprise. Woo! You like surprises? Joe, would you come up here, please, sweetheart? I'm so thankful for the leadership in our church. We have elders. We have a great staff. I want to say thank you to my staff. Thank you to the elders that serve our church. Thank you, staff. I mean, I've had a lot of people I've worked for and I've worked with over the years. The staff that God has given us, including Scott and Brenda, including Kurt and Anita, who I still think they're on staff even though they're not here. They're still in it and with us. And I think that God might do something in Lincoln someday, too, through them. Just a hunch I have. And I thank you for the staff of the Royal School of Ministry, Dr. D and Rev. I thank you, every leader, every Go Group leader, every serve team leader, our children's workers. Liz, I thank you for everything you've done. Christian, I mean, I could go on and on and on, but you guys make life so fun for me. I get to do what I love to do and love Jesus. God has got so much more for us. I'm going to read one scripture, and then I'm going to turn this to Joe. Isaiah 50, verse 7 says this. We can rise up and declare, I will not be dismayed. I have set my face like a flint to do his will, and I know that I will triumph. Guys, I want you to forget all your failures. I want you to forget all your successes. Why? Because you can't do anything about 5 minutes ago. You have this moment forward. And I am asking you to join Brent and I to set your face like a flint to the future God has for you and for us together. Don't be distracted. Don't compare yourself. Don't look over here. Don't look over there. Set your face like a flint. And when you do that, God himself promises that we will triumph. Amen? There's a lot of dreams inside of you. There are dreams inside of you. Let those dreams out. Get started. We are right here. Friday, I've got so many messages in me, but it's not, our time is done. But let me just please deposit this in you. Friday at sundown, begin the 10 days of awe, Rosh Hashanah. There's something very special for us when we lean into the feast, the seven feasts of the Lord. The feasts belong to God. These 10 days of awe are a time of preparation, a time of self-reflection, and yes, a time of repentance to say, God, strip me, take away anything that doesn't look like you. I'm going to set my face like a flint. Next Sunday is Yom Kippur. In the Jewish faith, it's the highest and holiest day of the year. Jews that never go to church any or temple any other time will go on Yom Kippur, trust me. But there's something here for us. So use these days. Do some research on the feasts and lean into this, because God is doing something new and he's breathing on his true church. Yes, there is a false church. The true church, those who he is speaking and he is saying, rise up. Do not be dismayed or moved by what you read in the news. That's a hot, hot mess. Can anybody say amen? Amen. Don't focus on that. Focus on him. Set your face like a flint and do not be moved or shaken, because God is going to pour out his spirit in these last days. We are at the beginning of the last days. I believe that. That is not to scare you. That's to stir you and encourage you, which is a perfect handoff, because this church is a go church. Everybody say go. This church is a go church. We have go groups. We have a go bus. And that little bus out there, thank you. Liz had the vision for that. And you guys gave to that. Joe, I'm going to hand this to you, and then we're going to have a nice surprise.
Good morning, everybody. You know, listening to everybody's testimonies, and we haven't heard them all, but if you really look at where this church has come, where they went and where they've come to in 6 years, you know, miracle in a mile, how we got this facility, Scott and Brenda, you know, gifting it to the church, moving out to Bismarck, starting another church, and we do have the African-American church, and we have Casa del Padre, so we do actually have several church plants already, yeah. So, but if you look at somebody's visions, Liz's visions, other people's visions that have been prophetic, they've come to pass. So, you know, if everybody saw the Go Bus when it pulled up here and it looked like a refrigerator, all it needed was an extension cord hanging out of the back. And you see what the vision and what it turned out to be and everything else that's, you know, having TVs in the youth room and everybody bringing things forward. You know, Brent having the motorcycle here, which, yeah. Alan, you did remind me, and forgive me, church, for not, because it's my responsibility to give good news reports. And we sold that motorcycle, and the proceeds went to new equipment for camera and for video, audio and stuff. And I should have given the report on that, because those are what somebody got blessed by giving it. You know, don't rob yourself of a blessing by not challenging God in the area of tithe, because he says that's the area he wants us to challenge him in. Don't rob yourself of a blessing. Put it out there and be amazed at what comes back. But anyways, my favorite thing saying is you don't drive your car looking in a rearview mirror. And like what Londa said, you know, what happened 2 seconds ago, you can't change, but God can. So have God be your windshield. You know, have him be your vision. Have him be your future. Anyways, lovely Mr. Brent and Pastor Londa have always had a vision to have bus ministries. And so we went out and purchased the Go Bus's dad. So you're going to see it in raw form, and I want you to have the vision. We're going to have a design drawn up, and we're going to do a wrap later on down the road. So but Brent's dad had a 2000 Ford F-350 two-wheel drive crew cab pickup with 225,000 miles on it that his brother had. And his brother had no idea, I believe, had no idea about the bus at that point. But we made an offer on this bus. Included in the bus, we have a mechanic, basically as long as he lives, is going to do all the mechanical work on the bus for no charge. We pay for the parts, which is overwhelmingly amazing. No, I didn't say that yet. We have a vision. Yeah, so in this bus, they spent $9,000 putting a new interior in the bus. Somebody from the congregation, the church that previously owned the bus, donated eight brand new tires on the bus. The air conditioning works on the bus. There's a DVD player on the bus. A DVD with four flat screens. There's a restroom. Please don't try to use it when it gets here, but there's a restroom on the bus. And yes, Liz, there is a bus here. And we're random acts of kindness. Brent had a vision of taking people down to the Ark to take a road trip. Now, the mechanic that did the DOT on this bus said he'd drive it to Florida tomorrow. So we want you to look through the vision with us. The bus you're going to see raw, it's not a lump of coal by all means. If I told you what we paid for it, you'd say no way. I mean, can I tell them what we paid for it?
Let them guess. It was a good deal. I'm just saying it was a good deal.
So here's the thing. Brent's father, which is deceased, had this truck. His brother donated it to the father's house. Brent went down and picked it up. We got it cleaned up. We sold it. And guess what? It sold for $400 more than what we paid for the bus. And it also covered having the cleanup done on the truck that was donated, some photos and stuff, and there was a little money left over. So this, you can't make this stuff up.
The free bus! Yes!
Woo! Woo! So keep this in the back of your mind. It's raw, just like the Go Bus. Go walk outside. You're going to see what the Go Bus looks like now if you haven't seen it by now. Imagine that is going to be somewhat of the design on the dad bus.
Let me talk just for a second.
Oh, no. Did you take your medication since the last round?
I did.
So we're going to be raising some money for the wrap. For it. We're going to start a fund for that. And so just be thinking about that, because we're going to do this first trip to the Ark. And if you're and just to kind of museum. Just what's that? And the Creation Museum. The Lord just told me the Creation Museum in my left ear. And so that's coming. And this is Random Acts of Kindness for our youth. We've been doing it for a long time, and now we have a vehicle to do it in. And we go to cities, big and small. We go to churches and do good stuff for people there, and God gets the glory for that. But if God speaks to your heart, we still have like $5,000 to go. Is that an honest somewhere in that area?
Yeah, we're not sure.
But that's going to be the wrap on it. But it's going to have the Father's house on it. And we're going to use it for kingdom stuff. And we have a way to get there now. So isn't God great?
Can you just share real quick what the Go Bus has been used for already? Do you want to do that, Liz? Christian? Yeah. Rachel?
So we've used the Go Bus so far. We've done a lot of park ministry where we've gone to parks and just loved on people. And it's actually been amazing because it's been Muslims that are in our area have been at these parks when we were going, and we get to love on them, and they're like, what are you doing? Why are you here? It's like, because we love you, because God loves you. And people are like completely blown away by this. And so we're able to go with this Go Bus and do so many things, and we've honestly been able to already impact just the community around us. And the Go Bus has helped pick up things that we've needed for the church. It's a bus that we've used for a lot of different things, and so it's been really amazing, and I'm excited. Yeah. I drove personally down to St. Paul and Minneapolis. So, I mean, this thing is going everywhere, all right? And so we are really excited about the future with this bus that we have, because first off, free bus. Come on, Jesus, right? But second, this is the whole vision of the Father's house. We're here to make God famous. We're here to know God and make him known. And this is the bus that's going to take us anywhere we need to go to do that. And so, like he said, it's a diamond in the rough right now. But man, let me tell you, it is an amazing bus. It is an amazing gift from God so that we can continue doing kingdom work. Hallelujah.
Amen. So here's what we're going to do. In 2 seconds, I know, thank you for a little extra time, everybody. This has been such a great day. Thank you for being here for our 6th birthday. Thank you for your love to me for my birthday. Elizabeth Key, I just see you slip in, sweetheart. This is your first time back here since your sweet husband went to heaven. We love you. And you're going to give, you got lots of elephants, girlfriend. So if you see Elizabeth outside, please give her a big hug. She's going to need it all these days and weeks ahead. And so the surprise is you now have a 48-passenger bus. And so what I'd like you to do, and there'll be a time after the wrap is done that we do an official dedication of the bus. But right now, I'd like you all to stand. And online, too, stick with us, because our camera's going to be out there, and you're going to get to see the bus, too. So I want to pray a blessing over you, and then I want us all very quickly, you can leave your kids. I mean, don't leave the parking lot without your kids, but leave your kids there for just a minute. I need you very quickly to go out that door, and everybody go outside, and then you're going to get to see our new bus that we're all going to be using for cool stuff. Yes, Joe.
Real quick, you know how they do the reveals on HD television? So when you go out there, just yell, "Move that church," so we can see the bus.
That's good. Father, bless this day. Thank you, God, for my family. Thank you for 6 years of your faithfulness to us. God, we set our face like a flint now to the future. Not looking to the side or to the back, and you will be our triumph. You are our victory in the name of Jesus. Thank you for this great gift. Lord, the legacy and just the gift of kindness from Brent's dad through his brother and to us that has totally paid for what we're about to see. God, you are so good. Thank you. I can't wait to hug him in heaven. And Lord, we love you. Be with us now as we go in your name. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen. All right, so everybody head outside to the road, and I'll see you out there. Music.
Hi, how are you?
Congratulations. Come on, Adam. Come on, guys. Oh, Elizabeth. Oh, look at you thinking of me and my birthday.
Dear.
Oh, honey.
Yes, today is Lamaria's birthday.
It is. I got to hug her. Come on, everybody. Everybody outside. Everybody outside. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Hi, Monica. Hi, beautiful girl. Everybody take a cookie. Get a cookie. Come on outside, everyone. Oh, Ish. Hi, honey.
My favorite. Look.
Come on, everybody. Come on. Come on, everybody. Come on out. I think it's that mic. Let me see. Which one? Oh, this one. Hi. Can you see me, everybody online? Hi, everybody. Come on out. Can we come out to the street so we can see? Come out here. Come on. Come out. So you're not going to even get to see it. Come on out here. Come on out this way. Yeah, everybody just line up right here. Right here. Come on, y'all. Come on, church. You guys have a bus. It'll be here in just a second. Grace that brought it down to me. It'll be here in just a second. Come on out, everyone. That God did span Calvary. Yeah. Yeah. Hey, Joe, are you in touch with him? Say your mercy and your grace was free. Hi, good to see you. Hey. Should be here any second.
At the last word on the bottom of the cover, that you, this cat, wants the yes cat.
The yes cat. Oh.
So
okay.
That is.
Then we're almost there.
Oh, there's a few things yet, but.
I just got to work on that back. Come on. Yeah.
The saying of he put one on there that he took out of everything, but I think it should be something that you can really think about.
Thank you for all. You're making my dream.
A
thousand stories of love. Yes, I am.
Seek your light, but I.